Hallelujah. Good evening, everyone. How is everyone this evening? Praise the name of Jesus. It's good to see you. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we thank you, Father, for, Lord, blessing us with such a wonderful church. And Father, thank you for your word tonight. Lord, we expect to receive exactly what you have for us. And Father, we put a draw and place a draw on the anointing that you placed on our pastor. Now, Father God, as she ministers the word, Lord God, we receive everything you have for us. And Father, we thank you that your word flows freely here. There is no hindrances in the name of Jesus. Lord God, that we are people who receive and expect to receive, Father. Our receptors, Father God, are wide open for what you have. And Father, we thank you. Father, this that you bless us with a great family. Father, thank you that, Father, our family is healed and whole, walking in divine health. Lord, there's not a weak or a feeble one among us. Lord, because of your promise, thank you that you bore all that, Jesus, on your back. Thank you that you have purchased divine health for us, strength for us, Father. We glorify you. We magnify you in Jesus' name. Amen. If you need a Bible tonight, raise your hand so we can make sure you receive one. Thank you, Lord. All right. Well, lift your Bible up with me and let's say this together. Say with me, this is my Bible. By faith, I am what it says I am. By faith, I have what it says I have. By faith, I can do what it says I can do. Tonight, I will be taught the Word of God. I boldly confess, my mind is alert, my heart is receptive. I will never be the same. I place a draw on the anointing to come forth to this woman of God to answer my prayers and to supply my needs. I am about to receive the incorruptible, indestructible, ever-living seed of the Word of God. This seed will continue to grow up as a tree in my life that delivers me from all affliction. I fully expect to see the Word confirmed through miracles, signs, and wonders out inside and outside of the church. I will never be the same. Never, never, never. I will never be the same in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, there's a lot of people who are putting up with sickness, putting up with disease, and, you know, allowing those things to dominate in their life and thinking this is the way it is, this is how it has to be because, you know, and that's the way the world goes. And, you know, it depends on what you're influenced by. Because if you're influenced by the Word of God, then you don't look at those things. You resist those things. You don't pay attention to them, meaning your attention is not on those things, right? But it's on what the Word of God says. In Deuteronomy, and I was trying to find the scripture real quick because it just came to me, but I think it's in Deuteronomy somewhere in Deuteronomy. I think it's in Deuteronomy 30, but it says that for us to cling to God, for he is your life. Amen. To cling to God. You know, we live in Florida and there's, you know, these hitchhikers. You know what I'm talking about? They cling to your clothing. They stick to you. Right? You know, they get in dog's furs and then you have a hard time getting them out. They cling, right? You know, that is just a fraction of the imagery God is trying to get over to us, the way we're supposed to respond or act toward God. 30:20, thank you. That's one I thought it was because I got it pulled up. I just didn't look at the whole verse. That one says, may you love the Lord your God, that you may obey his voice. And his voice, and that you may cling to him, for he is your life and the length of your days, that you may dwell in the land which the Lord swore to your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to give to them. So he is your life. You cling to him. And this clinging that he's talking about here is better clinging than the hitchhikers. Amen. Because, you know, hitchhikers, you can peel them off. When it comes to us clinging to God, you can't separate us. That's the kind of clinging he's talking about. You know, he's got a higher way of thinking than the world thinks, right? Because when you talk about clinging to something and to the world, They think about something that can be easily removed, but it still sticks. No, this is not easily removed. As a matter of fact, when you become one with the Lord, you can't be removed. Amen? Just because you're one. But also, when you double up or when you look at it and magnify it the way the Lord views it, is that when we're clinging to Him, we're holding on to Him so tightly. Listen, He's not wanting to let go. He doesn't want us to let go either. But the world and the devil and all the circumstances of life, you know what that's trying to do? It's trying to get your mind off of who you're clinging to. And you know, sickness and disease tries to cling. Problems try to cling to you. But as disciples, is what we've been learning about, as disciples, we don't pay attention to what's trying to cling to us, like the attention we're paying to the one we're clinging to. You follow me, right? I mean, we acknowledge it's there. We acknowledge its existence. We don't pretend like it's not there. But at the same time, we're not giving our attention to that. We're paying attention to the one we're clinging to, not what's trying to cling to us and get us to let go. You follow me? And, you know, in Jeremiah, I'm not ministering tonight, by the way, Pastor Terry. Jeremiah chapter 2 and verse 13, it says, "My people have committed two evils." He says, "They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters." Just stop there and think about that for a minute. You're dying of thirst, and He's your answer, right? And you know what? Christians are guilty. I've been guilty. All right? For forsaking Him, the one that has all my answers, all right, or ignoring Him, okay, that's the same thing as forsaking, all right, except forsaking here is talking about I'm turning around and going the other way. I'm not paying attention to you anymore. I'm putting my back to you, and I'm paying attention to everything else. I'm giving my attention to other things. That's the same thing as forsaking, all right? And so He says His people have committed this, and He calls it evil. When we turn to other things, when we stop paying attention to God and we start focusing on Him as a source of everything that we need, right? He's the fountain of living water. It doesn't sound like something's running dry here. It's a fountain. A fountain flows, right? A fountain never stops flowing. It continues to flow. And what flows out of the fountain called God is living waters. You can't live without water. And this living water He's talking about is what will cause you to never thirst again, but still want more. Amen. And then He says, "And have hewn themselves cisterns." And then He says, "Broken cisterns that can't hold any water." A cistern is just a water container. It was a large water container is what it's referring to. But He's saying, you've tried to make these things happen all on your own. He's talking to His people. And just because He lives on the inside of you doesn't mean that we're doing everything that He wants us to do, paying attention to Him. Right? I've done these things. I've tried to develop my own answer. That's hewing out my own cistern. Amen? Thinking that's going to sustain me. Don't let me get in your business now. I mean, somebody will look at me like, that just doesn't apply to me. Oh, if I got in your business, it would apply to you. Okay? Because anything that you put your attention on, I just can't live without that. Listen, we're approaching Christmas time, all right? December 25th or whenever you guys exchange gifts and all that. And, you know, leading up to that point, I don't know about you, but we have been actually buying gifts for different people, right? I mean, that's a good thing, right? Yet a lot of us pay attention to the gifts and pay attention to all that, you know, gift giving and exchanging and all that kind of stuff, and not the source of the reason that we're celebrating the whole thing all together. You follow me? I mean, we're getting, caught up in the propagation of all the commercials, and, you know, we look at all these stores that are selling this, and then on your phone you get daily reminders of what the daily sale is. You know why I know that, right? Because I look at them, okay? Saying, well, yeah, that would be nice for this person. That would be nice for me. That would be nice, you know, for that person and all that kind of stuff. And that's all good. But let's not forget about who it is that we're actually celebrating here. Amen? We're celebrating the birth of Christ. Let's not forget that. And let's not try to hew out cisterns or something that we think is going to make us happy or sustain us, all right, all on our own, because it won't work. Those things, you know, cisterns dry up. Think about the cistern. Come on, Pastor. Think about it. It's a container. It doesn't have fresh water flowing in all the time. Water gets stagnant. That doesn't sound like a desirable thing to me, amen? Let's stick with the fountain of living waters.
Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Should have just sat back there and listened. Sorry. Hallelujah. Lord, we honor you and praise you. And Lord, we thank you. Lord, our heart's desire is to be vessels. Lord, first, that are valuable to you. Because, Lord, you said that we choose the type of vessel that we are and that we desire to be vessels that you can use. And, Lord, we thank you and praise you. And, Father, I thank you that when I speak, I'll speak as the oracles of God. And as I minister, I'll do it with the ability that you supply, that in all things that you alone are glorified in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. That was a good message. We're going to open up to Matthew chapter 5. And we're going to start in verse 6 or 13, Matthew 5:13. And you know, I was thinking about this time of the year, and sometimes we talk about being, holding on to our peace. We talked about that last week, right? Because it's very important that we keep our peace at a time when people are losing their minds, at Walmart or anything. And so, but we have a choice as to whether or not we stay in peace or we don't. Peace is the fruit of the Spirit. Peace is not an emotion. And so we can have heart peace even when things are not going right around us. And we need to remember that. And that actually creates for us to be a light in this world, because people will see your peace and they won't understand why you have peace, but people know when somebody's at peace and when someone is not. And so we're going to talk about this. And then the other part of it is that since Jesus is the greatest gift ever given, he is the original Christmas present. And we're going to have an opportunity on Saturday to go out and offer the greatest gift ever given to our community through the outreach at the Christmas parade. And if you haven't signed up for it, let Rick and Trina know if you're going to come out so that they can have a good idea of schedule and stuff. But this is one of the greatest things that we can do as a believer, as a disciple, is to minister salvation to someone else. And we have a phenomenal tool to utilize. So on Saturday, we are going to have a tent at the Christmas parade, and we're going to raffle off a Yeti cooler. And we are willing to do just about anything to get people into the kingdom of God. And so we got a Yeti cooler, which, if you don't know, it's a big deal. Top of the line, it's like the Lamborghini of coolers. And for some people, that's a thing. And then we're going to see a lot of people want to get that cooler. So with that said, we're going to have, for their entry, they have to fill out a survey. And the survey will be the very same The very same evangelism tool that we used when we went to Walmart, except for it's in writing. Has anybody ever told you God loves you? And they're going to check off the survey. And then in order to win the Yeti cooler, they need to fill out the bottom. And then we'll do a drawing. Now, it sounds like a gimmick, but here's the thing. They actually have to read the gospel in order to enter. Or have one of us read it to them. Like, you know how you get approached, hey, let me do this little survey with you. And so we're going to do that. And part of that is because one of the things that we get to do as a believer is bring fruit to our King. When someone gets saved, that is fruit that abounds to your account, and you get to offer your King a gift. You get to offer your Savior a gift. And that was the first gift you gave him was surrendering your heart to him, giving him all that you are, right? Presenting yourself and giving him your heart. And then the second thing you can do is serve him. And that's a gift. It's not required of us, right? All disciples should serve him, but not, it's not a requirement to get into heaven. So here Jesus is speaking in Matthew chapter 5, verse 13. It says, "You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is then good for nothing but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men. You are the light of the world." Say, "I am the light of the world." You are a city that is set on a hill that cannot be hidden. Nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. When we go out and we do outreach, whether it's this one or any other outreach, we are the light of the world. And in the midst of darkness, that's when we shine brightest, right? You could have a very faint light, but if every other light is out, then you're going to see it brighter. Did you ever go out into like a countryside somewhere? I mean, really here, we don't have to go that far. You could go out into like, out west in Okeechobee or something like that, and just look up in the sky if it's a clear night. It looks like stars that have never been there before, but the reality is those stars are there here too. It's all of the light that kind of drowns it out, and we don't see it as bright. But when there's nothing but darkness, those lights just shine so bright. And so we get to be those lights when there's darkness. We're not afraid of the darkness. We are not intimidated by the darkness. The light drives out darkness. Verse 16. Let your light so shine before men. So we actually have to give that light permission to shine. I honestly want us to think about that. Jesus is saying, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. Let them see it. That gives the implication that you can also not let them see it. We have to choose to let people see the light in us. Some people dampen their light. They put it under a lamp, under a basket or something, because they're embarrassed by the light. Don't be embarrassed by the light. It's the greatest gift that we have to give to people in darkness. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. People will know that we're different, right? That we're peculiar people, that we're his chosen people. And it was funny, it's gotta be 18 years ago, right? That we did MASH, and we were, I was paired up with Miss Flo, and we were walking around, and we always went 2x2, unless I had some teens with me, and then we had a few extra people. But Miss Flo and I were walking, and we were in Fort Pierce, and it was a chain link fence around this yard, and We went, we knocked on the door, nobody answered. We got outside of her fence and we're walking around and the people chased us down because she said, "You guys are Christians, you're not Jehovah's Witnesses. I want to hear what you have to say. Let your light shine," right? And we had a good old time because people just kept coming around us. Just right in that very spot. And people started gathering and it was awesome to pray with other believers. But you have to allow your light to shine. People will recognize it and they'll glorify your Father in heaven. Amen. Amen. And we're gonna be a light to the world. We're gonna be and you know, there's gonna be all kinds of people there, you know, because they titled it years ago, they titled it Festival of Lights. And there's going to be people from every walk of life there. But we know who the one light is. And we know that he put his light on the inside of us. And so it is going to be a festival of lights because we're going to be there. Amen. And so we as the lights are going to be there to minister light to people who are in darkness and encourage other lights to shine brightly. Amen. Because, you know, people can get discouraged. You ever been discouraged? You ever have situations present themselves that make you go, ugh, right? You feel deflated, right? And you're just sitting there and you're thinking, I just don't know. Well, you have somebody come over and see you or talk to you who's a light, it starts to get you stirred back up. Right? It's a stirring on the inside of us, reminding us who we are, and we're speaking spirit to spirit. We're calling on that strength of the Holy Spirit to strengthen us with our inner man, to strengthen us, to help us brighten and shine brighter for all to see. And it's up to us to yield to that, right? It's up to us to be around other Christians in order to be built up. And it's up to us to be the Christians who are building, not tearing down. Amen? Amen. Now, we expect miracles to happen, but it's not just something that we say during our confession, right? Do we have an expectation for miracles or not? Yes. If we have an expectation for miracles, you know, you might think the pressure's on you. It is not. We said inside and outside of the church. One day, somebody's going in and editing that slide to say, through me, right? Because we need to understand that God wants to use each of us to minister miracles to people, right? We want to encourage people to receive a miracle, whether they're saved or not. Everybody who Jesus gave a miracle to before he went to the cross was not saved. Right? Before the resurrection, nobody was saved. And yet, miracles flowed freely through Jesus to people. So it's not a qualifier, okay, get saved and then you can receive a miracle. Miracles are actually one of the ways that a lot of people end up getting saved. Right? Because the world has all these spectacular things, and the reality is that those things truly are counterfeits of the real spectacular. But the church has allowed the spectacular to dim within the church, and we became religious and we don't have this expectation anymore. And we need to build our expectation because it's not us performing the miracles. Matthew Mark 16, and starting in verse 15 is the Great Commission. And Jesus tells us, he says, go out into all the world. Go. Yes. What did I say? Sorry. It was really rough when I was a cashier. Mark 16:15. Thank you all. And he said to them, go, 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 go. Do you know y'all, we all get too comfortable staying. Well, just let them show up at the church. You know, because like if they actually want Jesus, they'll show up at a church. Whether they want Jesus or not, they need Jesus. Do you understand that? Like I don't know about you, but I was not seeking a church. I was in a church. Let me explain. I was in a church and I still wasn't hearing anything to get me saved. So I wasn't looking for a new church. I was in one. I was doing what I was supposed to do. If it hadn't been for God having me have this dissatisfaction on the inside of me because I was listening to radio ministers that actually were relatively sound, but at least at minimum believed in receiving salvation. Had it not been for that, I would still be sitting there decaying and living a life that wasn't fulfilling. Do you understand? But he told us to go out into all the world. He didn't say put up a billboard and tell people to come in. We're actually supposed to bring people in with us. You go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Now, I always found this interesting because why didn't Jesus say to every person? I mean, because he's real specific. He loves people. So why do you say preach the gospel to every creature? I think he gives us the idea, start wherever you can. And, you know, some people don't see other people as people. Some people see their flaws, see their shortcomings, don't count them to have a value. Remember, remember the woman caught in the very act of adultery, right? They bring her in, they throw her in front of Jesus, and they say, what do you say about this? The law says that such should be stoned. Not she, not women caught in the act of adultery, such. And take the value, the human value out of that person. And we start to see them for their flaws, for their mistakes, for their sin, rather than seeing them as a person that God wants saved. We are not called to judge and determine whether or not somebody is worth salvation. He said to preach to every creature. It's his job to bear witness with their spirit. It's his job to have the Holy Spirit draw that person to repentance. Your job is to tell good news. Gospel means good news. That's why I'm not big on saying, do you know you're going to go to hell? Because that is not good news. Good news is God loves you. Once you call upon the Lord Jesus Christ and you're saved, you're going to heaven regardless of what mistakes you've made. Before or after you get saved. How many of y'all know we're still in flesh? Anybody else ever make a mistake since you got saved? Today? Right? I mean, we don't have to think that far distant in the distant past to think, oh, wow, it's not, It hasn't been that long since we made a mistake, right? But it's not a disqualifier because we were not the qualification. Jesus is our qualification. And so he tells us, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. I'm telling you, when I got a hold of this, that I'm going to see my cat in heaven. That cat was saved. She had no choice. I mean, I'm not trying to create any false doctrine. Please don't like take that and run with it. I'm just saying I took every creature seriously, right? One, because she couldn't talk back. She didn't tell me how many mistakes I made when I was telling her how to get saved. That was nice. Anybody ever talk to people and wish they had a muzzle? Right? And you're just like, stop. Listen, we need to have confidence that it's God's, first of all, it's God's will that all men be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. That is his will for every person's life. Not every person is going to walk in God's will. Right? When people talk about being the predestination and things, the thing that will be fulfilled that the devil cannot thwart is Jesus winning. Right? That Jesus is on the throne, that's already finished. And he's coming back for us. And the devil cannot mess with that at all. But he can mess with our own destinies if we buy into his lies. If we latch on to one of his lies, that's how we get derailed from fulfilling our own destiny. You're not going to automatically fulfill God's purpose and plan for your life. It does not work that way. You have to pursue God's purpose and plan for your life. You have to say, Lord, what is your will in this situation? And I want to cooperate with it. Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane said, Lord, Father, if there's any way for this cup to pass for me, let it pass. Yet not my will be done, but your will be done. He submitted his will to God's will. He was unwilling to just say, I'm going to do this my own way. And unfortunately, so many of us do. Go into all the world and preach. Now, here's the thing. We're going to see in just a moment, he says, start here and work out. It's a ripple effect, which was the same effect he had with his disciples. First, he had 12, and then he had 70, and then it multiplied, right? And now there's a huge portion of the world. But you don't have to go outside of even Port St. Lucie, the state of Florida, the U.S., in order to be preaching to all the world. When God said, God so loved the world that he gave, he's talking about everybody outside of you. He included you. And then you got saved and he brought you into the kingdom, right? So you're no longer, you are in the world, but you are no longer of the world. But when he says go into all the world, it means other people who don't know him, go tell them about him. Go tell them the good news. Go tell it on the mountain. We don't have any mountains in Florida, so you're just going to have to go out into the festival. And go tell it, right? That Jesus Christ is born for us. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned. Okay. Our job is to go and be that vessel. Just a vessel. And then it says, and don't get bogged down on the baptized. We want to get people baptized and baptized as quickly as we can. And the reason for that is it marks in their thinking. It marks in their thinking a change was made. I was buried with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. It marks our thinking. That is our death and burial into Christ, and we're resurrected in him. That old life I leave behind. It's important for us to mark our thinking with that. And he who does not believe will be condemned. It's not the sin that's condemning. It's the believing. Rejecting the gift of Jesus. And these signs will follow those who believe. Who believes in here? What do you believe? That Jesus is the Son of God, that he died for your sin, and that God raised him from the dead. You believe that?
Yes.
Then you are a believer.
Yes.
These signs might follow you,
will.
Could follow you,
will.
Should follow you.
Will.
Say what?
Will
follow you. These signs will follow me.
Yes.
In Jesus' name, I will cast out demons. Let's all say that together. In Jesus' name, I will cast out demons. Now, I don't recommend that you walk up to everybody at the festival and cast out their demon. I just don't recommend it. Might be having some conversations with my coworkers if you do that. But listen, we're not afraid of the devil. We have authority in the name of Jesus. This is Jesus speaking, right? This is after his resurrection. He's come back. He's talking to the disciples, and he says, these signs will follow those who believe. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. You baptized in the Holy Spirit? Listen, we need to kick this up a notch. I'm just going to say, if you're not praying in tongues every day, start up. If you need to start with 3 minutes, 5 minutes, I'm not giving you a this is what you have to do right here, right now, but I'm telling you that it is our power, it's our charging cord, right? We plug into the outlet. The outlet is the source of the energy, right? The source of the charge. But your battery can be running low, and especially with all the darkness going on in the world, you need to recharge. Praying in tongues helps you to recharge. Not enough yeses to that one. They will take up serpents. Okay, let's pause on this one. We are not a snake handling church. You have the wrong pastor for that. Victoria might go, oh, but I'd like to do that. The answer is no. What form did the devil use when he came to Adam and Eve? He approached them as a serpent. This is a spiritual thing. Now, there are snake handling churches, and I will never attend them. Unless God, there's no scenario by which God would send me. But the devil came as a serpent, right? Now, you cast out demons when somebody is demon-possessed. But when somebody's oppressed, you take up serpents. You take them up off of the person. In the name of Jesus, it's the same. How the same way you cast out demons is the same way you take up serpents. And if they drink anything deadly, it will by no means hurt them. Now, you ought to be, everything that you drink, everything that you eat, should be sanctified unto the Lord. We have an expectation that we are not going to have anything hurt us. Amen? They will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. We have an expectation. Listen, people after an encounter with us should have had an encounter with Jesus. And after they've had an encounter with us and with Jesus, they should be different. There should be a sense of relief having been around us. Have you spent time around people and you just feel lighter? Like things just are not so gloomy and have you ever been around people like that? Do you like to be around people like that? Yeah, me too, right? Have you been around the opposite? Did you know you have a choice as to which one you are? What you allow to influence you? You know, it was funny. There was a situation recently, and I told Pastor Kurt, I said, you know, until I got home and he and I started talking, that person, their ability to deceive, dominate, and control caused me to not see something until I was away from it. And then I saw it clearly. Like in retrospect, it was like, boom, my eyes were open, right? And the Lord just had the whole thing just replay in front of my head, and it all just made perfect sense. But in that moment, I couldn't see it. See, we need to be people of discernment, and we also need to be able to discern when not to be around someone. Isn't that unloving? No, it's called wisdom. But we also have the ability to take up serpents, cast out demons, lay hands on the sick and they will recover, right? Go back to the beginning of that verse for me, please. So he says, they will take up serpents, and if they drink anything deadly, it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. Now, tell me, do you think that after having an encounter with us doing this, somebody is going to feel built up or torn down? Built up, not torn down. Listen, there's no reason to discourage people. They can get that themselves. Right? Anybody have a smartphone? You can get discouraged like that. No problem. But to be built up, to be edified, it comes through the Spirit of God, which we have living on the inside of us, which is that light, right? There should be a light that, not just a light glow, but a lightness that people experience after having been around us. And then he goes on and he says, well, it says, so then after the Lord had spoken to them, he was received up into heaven and sat down at the right hand of God. Now, this is what the disciples did and we are doing. And they went out, preached everywhere, and the Lord working with them and confirming the word through accompanying signs. Amen. The Lord is the one who performs the signs as the confirming of his word. See, we're not on the spot. It's not, think of it this way. It's not your name on the line. It's his. And we do not choose to impose a judgment on another human being as to whether they have the ability to get saved or not. I am so grateful with the way that I was living life that, God had to use a radio ministry, but that there were still people witnessing to me though. They didn't judge my life and say, there ain't no way you're getting saved. You're too far gone. You're not too far gone and they're not too far gone. You know, it's usually the people who are so far over into the world that when they get saved, they go so far into the kingdom of God. They're extremists. And God loves when those people get saved because they get passionate and on fire. And Jesus said it this way. He said, tell me, Simon, who loves more, the one for whom much is forgiven or a little? And he said, I suppose the one for whom much was forgiven. And he said, you say rightly. Why? Because the one who got saved, who knew they were a sinner, they know it wasn't them. The people who get saved because they've just always been good people and they just always love Jesus, listen, they're important too. We do not discount that. We don't reject it. We embrace it because you know what? Those people have a phenomenal testimony as well, that God preserved me from the world and I didn't go the way of the world. I'm telling you what, I will take either testimony. It's just that those people, the latter of the two people, the people who, you know, they've just always been good. Do you know sometimes we shy away from ministering salvation to those people because we figure, well, they're good. They must know God. What's really weird is there are some super nice people out there that don't know Jesus. And there's some really not nice people out there who do know Jesus or have met him. Right? There's a difference between knowing him. And we are not to judge people. We're to ask people, hey, do you know God loves you? Hey, if you died today, do you know where you'd go? Right? Because honestly, it provokes the thought. Because people say, yeah, I know God loves me, but that doesn't mean that they've received him. It doesn't mean that they have embraced salvation. Do you know, it took me, I don't know how long it took me. Give me just a second, I'll think about this. I'm going to suspect it took me 3 years from the time that I got saved to the time to get to know Jesus, start to get to know Jesus. Because I got saved driving to work and it was at least 2 years or possibly three before I met Pastor Kurt, which is when I started getting to know the Lord. Before that, I was saved. I was sliding into heaven. I think of those in my mind, okay, because once you've received Jesus, you're just in, right? But in my mind, I think of, like, you know, the gates closing, and I'm sliding underneath, like, just got in, like, because I didn't know how to serve him. It wasn't that I didn't love him. It's not that I didn't want to, but I had no idea who he was. He always knew me. But I was saved and not serving him, so I had no idea how to serve God. Do you understand what I'm saying? It is so important for us to offer Jesus to everyone without looking at the outward, because God knows their inward condition. John 10:10, very familiar scripture. John 10:10 says, "The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it more abundantly." In the Amplified, it says, "to the full till it overflows." Yes. Right? And so we need to realize that some people are not living an abundant life. Right? Why? Because the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Do you know some people confuse that, coming to steal, kill, and destroy, as God's will? It's true, I know, because I believed it. You believe what you're taught. You believe what you've had a renewed mind to. And if you've never been taught anything, your logic would dictate, well, because everybody says, well, God's in control. If God is in control, he's doing a terrible job running this place. Just be honest. If God is in control, why is everybody running amok out there in the world? He is not in control of everything. But there's a doctrine that even the lost believe, They don't have to believe in Jesus to believe, oh, God's in control. Oh, you know, God must have a purpose and a plan for this. God will work this out. No. Am I just talking to myself? And people believe that because they don't know that Jesus said, the thief does not come except to steal, to kill, and to destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it more abundantly. They don't know that's in the Bible, and most of them don't care. They just want to believe what they believe. And so many people are blaming God for all their problems and not realizing there's a devil coming to steal, kill, and destroy. He wants to steal from us. He wants to steal our peace. He wants to kill our families. He wants to destroy our relationships. That's his purpose. He's a destroyer. He hates God and he hates what God stands for. And God stands for life and for good. And you know what's so funny is even after I got saved, it took years to get my mind renewed to bring me back to a place where I believed what God said was right. Did you ever disagree with God? You know, that's a little outdated. Anybody? Listen, I pray for the kids who I used to teach in the Catholic Church because I said some crazy stuff out of sheer ignorance. And I'm like, Lord, just send a laborer across their path whose voice they can hear and respond to. Because I would say crazy stuff because I didn't know better. Do you understand? Yes. Because your logic will say, oh, well, God's got to be in control then. If he's God, right? They don't realize God gave us authority. He gave us free will. That's why Jesus submitted his will to the will of the Father, right? And that we're told to submit ourselves to God. And people accuse God of all the problems going on. They don't know that this is there. Oh, I don't know why God let this happen to me. No, it's called an attack. Right? And my people perish for a lack of knowledge and for rejected knowledge. So even the Christians are perishing for rejected knowledge. The thief does not come except to steal, to kill, and destroy. When he shows up, he's coming with a mission. But Jesus came that we would have life and have it more abundantly. His heart's desire is an abundant life. People need to know that. That's good news. John 3:16-17. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Pause here for a second. Here is the truth. This is what Christmas is about. This is the purpose of Christmas. Is because of God's love, that he sent his Son, and he sent his Son with a purpose, and his Son fulfilled the purpose. He fulfilled it because God wanted for us to be a part of his family. He does not want us to perish. People are perishing left and right because we need to be bold, and we need to get out there, and we need to share the good news. And verse 17 is for all the people who want to reject the gospel because they're not worthy in and of themselves. Jesus said, God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. There's so many people who think that they've gone too far, that God can't save them, that they've done too much wrong, that they've whatever. It's a lie. It's a lie. And we cannot buy into that lie. God is a God of redemption. And he's not a God of condemnation. He wants for everyone to know, no matter what you've done, I love you. I'm not condemning you. I'm saving you. Sozo is this word here. And that word sozo means to be whole, to be restored, to do well, to be healed. It is all inclusive of all of the benefits of God within the word. I came to give it to you. Ephesians 1:7. In him, that's in Jesus, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sin according to the riches of his grace. No, we're stopping at 7. Otherwise, it'll be 9:00. Listen, we can read Ephesians all day, and there's so much richness in there that we won't stop. But we... Just check. We and the world need to know that it is through Jesus that we have redemption. Through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. We didn't earn it. We can't earn it. It's impossible because it required God to shed his own blood. God was personally present in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself. We can't do this. We can receive this. And all the world needs to know the good news about Christmas. Amen? And so I speak boldness over you in the name of Jesus. And I say that as we, as a body, go forth and minister, especially this Christmas season, that God gives us the right words at the right time, that we don't take rejection personally, but we look at people and we love them the way that God loves them. That we permit God's love to flow through us to others and to make a difference in our community and in this state and in the country and around the world. And Lord, we glorify you and praise you. Lord, I thank you for utterance. Lord, I thank you for favor. And Father, I thank you that as all of us go forth, whether it's at the festival or elsewhere, and we're ministering your good news, Father, that we speak your word with love. We speak the truth with love and boldness in the name of Jesus. That we can make you known throughout the land. And that people will walk in freedom knowing that you have redeemed them from their life from destruction. And Father, we glorify you and praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Come on up, Rick. Give everybody an opportunity to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior. I guess you're receiving an offering, too. I love you all.
It's a great inroad to it. It's a great inroad.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Everybody doing good? Because you came in one way and you're leaving another. Hallelujah. You know, I just have the heart for people because I know where I've been. I know the dirt I've crawled around in, right? I know the misery that I've lived in. I know the heartache that I had, and I know the hope that I didn't have. I know what it feels like to live without hope, to feel the rejection. I know what it feels like. But now I know that despite all of that, I have my best friend who loves me despite everything that I've done. And guess what? He loves you too. And he loves you too. He's absolutely in love with everything about you because he has no choice, because he died for the sins that you condemn yourself of. But he didn't come, like it says, John 3:17, to condemn you. He came to save you. Right now is your opportunity to do that, to be saved, to allow all that condemnation to go and just fall at Daddy's feet. Let's close our eyes, bow our head. Also, if you're on the internet and you're listening now or a little bit later and you're just sitting there and you're wanting hope, this is your opportunity for hope because there's people in here who have been there and they have cried out. And they've needed Jesus. And you, whether you know it or not, need Jesus. This is a great season to meditate on the fact that we have the opportunity to have him, that he came here. He was born, lived a life for us, only for us, for you, me, to live this earth, walk this earth, to demonstrate to us what pure love is. And he said, you know what? Here you are. I'm your gift. I'm your gift. It's free. You don't have to do anything. All you have to do is accept me. You have to make me your Savior, to believe in what I've done for you. And for me, it wasn't hard. After I got to the point where I was just hopeless, make this choice tonight that you want to give your life over to Jesus. Repeat after me. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your Son. Jesus, here I am. I give my life to you. I accept you. I believe in you. I confess you. I repent of my sins and I lay them at your feet. Come into me. You're my Savior and I accept that. Holy Spirit, lead and guide me. I surrender myself to you. In Jesus' name. Amen. That's real, isn't it? That's just real. If you made that decision, whether it's here tonight or if you rededicated your life to the Lord or if you gave your life to the Lord, we want to hear about it. We do, because we don't want to just save you and get you into heaven and say, you know what, you're on your own now. Figure it out. So we don't want to do that, right? So talk to us, talk to anybody here, tap us on our shoulder, say, hey, listen, we made a decision. If you're online and if you made that decision and you feel like you're alone, you're not, give us a call. Our address is on Facebook and YouTube, and our phone number is on Facebook, YouTube, any kind of social media platform. Email us, let us know, talk to us, get us your information, because we want to put material in your hand. The email address is up here. It's at connect@reallifefl.com. And put in the subject line, Jesus is my Savior. And we'll get the information to you that you need. Amen. Hallelujah. Isn't that awesome? Man, that's awesome. I don't know. It just gets me fired up. I'm really excited about Saturday. I hope you are. I hope to see all of you there. And let's worship the Lord with our giving tonight, okay? This is another form of worship. We worship with the Lord with our praises and our life and worship and getting in the Word. But this is another form of worship is he gave us what we've got and we're giving back to him because we're thankful and we're absolutely in love with what he's given us. He's given us talents. Each one of us have a talent. And if we didn't have him to give us that talent, we wouldn't be able to give it back. And let's not give him that money and hold on to it and do the tug of war thing, right? Let's do it cheerfully. Cheerfully. And give him that. So your tithes, your offering, it's getting sown into great ground. Hallelujah. Great ground. It takes finances to do what we do, right? We're blessing people on Saturday. We bless people here in the church. We bless people all over the world with a real-life church and Kurt Owen Ministry. It's amazing ground to sow into. Amen. Hallelujah. So take your tithe and your offering in your hand and say this with me. Thank you to Heavenly Father that you've given to me. I give back to you with a cheerful heart, and I worship you. And I thank you that you've given back to me, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. And I praise you, Lord, for it. I thank you for the ground that I'm giving into. In Jesus' name, amen. So as you're giving, we'll do it in the boxes on our way out. I've got a couple announcements. First announcement, once again, we have the Festival of Lights this Saturday. It's going to be from 2 o'clock to 10 o'clock at night. sign up, let me know, because I'm getting the final details of the schedule. I'm going to send that out tomorrow. And if you want to be on the schedule to just kind of walk around or man the booth or just be out there or be at the parade, let me know. And we're going to get all the information, send a text out or call or email tomorrow and just kind of remind everybody of the colors and the times and everything else. We're going to be needing some volunteers to staple some candy canes to the flyers when we get them. So it'll be it's going to be an awesome time. We had a blast last year. We're going to have more fun this year. So that's going to be Saturday from, 2 o'clock to 10 o'clock. The parade's at 6 o'clock. And we're just going to have a blast. Corporate prayer, that was last night from 6:30 to 7:30. And let's not just wait for emergencies, right? Let's do it in the good times and praise and worship him in the good times, because there are going to be times coming where we're going to need it, right? Amen. So get together corporately from 6:30 to 7:30 on Tuesday nights. There are volunteers that are needed in the children's ministry. 2 assistants needed. That's only 1 Sunday per month. So if you want to do that, if it's on your heart, sign up, talk to Minister Curtis or Linda about that. Let's see. There's going to be a Christmas party December the 16th, hallelujah, for the kids and the ministry back there from 1 to 3. So if you want to be a part of that, sign up back there also as well. And our mission is to make and marshal disciples. Man, we've been marshaled this year. Whew, it's been so good. Been so good. But we got to apply it. We got to apply it to our life. You can listen all day long, but it doesn't mean a thing unless you start applying it. Amen? I love you guys. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you. I thank you for the ministry that comes forth from this platform, and that we take the words of encouragement and wisdom and we do apply them in our life. Whether it's here, whether it's out at the store or in our home, that we go into the world and we tell people about the gospel of Jesus Christ, that we apply the words that we learn here to our life, because it is the recipe for freedom, Father. I call everybody here supernaturally blessed, supernaturally provided for, supernaturally healthy, and I thank you so much, dear Heavenly Father. We have the authority to be able to do that. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah.